Lord, I come before you with contrite heart. Humbly I surrender all that I am. I want to learn from you. Please draw me close to you. Let me share your love and grace in all I do. Oh Lord, transform me. Change my heart completely to be more like you. Oh Lord, renew me. Heal my mind and broken heart today. I want to be and to do what you commanded and be filled with the Spirit every day. To serve you wherever you may lead me. I want to serve you till the very end. Oh Lord, transform me. Change my heart completely to be more like you. Oh Lord, renew me. Heal my mind and broken heart today. To be and to do what you commanded, and be filled with the Spirit every day. I want to serve you wherever you may lead me. I want to serve you till the very end.
Happy Sabbath and good morning, family abroad in St. Lucia, overseas and over trees. Welcome to the National Sabbath Service brought to you by the St. Lucia Mission of Seventh-day Adventists. My name is Wendy Frederick.
And I am Anna Howell.
And we are here to bring you this live service this morning. But before we do anything, we want to offer a word of prayer. Even though we're not in the building, it is still church. So let us assume a posture of prayer as we pray. Father in heaven, we want to thank you, Lord, for the blessing of the 6 days of toil and labor. Some of us did not toil in a normal way, but we were home toiling and you kept us. You protected us. We are here. We are alive. And we just want to thank you for all these blessings and then some. Father, we ask that you forgive us for anywhere we have gone wrong. Any sin that we have left unconfessed, Lord, we bring it for you this morning, that you will take it away and replace it with joy. We pray, Lord, that we will continue to allow you to have your way with us. Bless every person here that will be doing something in this service to bless your people. May you inspire them. May you give them clarity of thought. And may this service draw all of us closer to you. Those who are not of your fold, who are tuned in, we ask for a special visitation by your Spirit that you will convict them to say yes to you. Let your will be done and let your name be honored, I pray, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Let me welcome you once again. Throughout this week, I decided, let me search Google to find out how do we say welcome, happy Sabbath in different languages. I was able to get many, many, many languages. I just want to share just a few with you. In Italian, benvenuto, sabato, felice. In Haitian Creole, bienveni, bon repos. In Spanish, bienvenido, buen sabado. In English, welcome, happy Sabbath. But there was one language I searched high and low and I could not get Sister Howell. Can you guess what it is? You will not guess.
German?
Well, yes, Google had German. But Google did not have the language of Canaan. And I wanted to say happy Sabbath in the language of Canaan. And I could not get it. But what I realized is, when we get to heaven, that's when we will know how to say happy Sabbath in the language of Canaan.
I'm sure that will be one of your first questions to God, right?
Well, it wouldn't be a question. I will automatically know how to say it, praise the Lord. So our listeners, our viewers can have access to this service on various channels. Can you share that with us?
Yes, there are various platforms which you could view us on. Some include Praise FM Radio 98.5 and 92.5 FM, www.praisefm.org, St. Lucia Mission of SDA YouTube page, LNO Studios YouTube page, LNO Studios Facebook page, Great Vision Design TV, channel 115-115 on Flow.
All right, thank you for that, Sister Howell. Now, the General Conference has taken a very important and great initiative, especially in these last days and what we're experiencing now globally. So they have introduced 100 days of prayer and fasting. Well, it's 100 days of prayer, but I believe that some of us would be fasting during that time. And this week's theme, they're going to have a weekly theme, and this week's theme is
peace in the midst of a pandemic.
That's right. Peace in the midst of a pandemic. We are able to still have peace because God gives us peace,
yes,
not as the world giveth. So we are able to have peace in this pandemic because we are children of the King. So we're inviting you, if you have not signed up for that 100 days of prayer and fasting, to do so now via this platform, www.revivalandreformation.org/100 days. Let me say that again, www.revivalandreformation.org/100 days. That's what will be taking place for the next 100 days. It started yesterday, the 27th, so you're not too late to join this wonderful initiative.
And Wendy, as we continue, more information will be given.
That's for sure.
Okay, so at this time, we invite you to join us in singing as we blend our voices with the praise team.
Indeed.
Morning, church. I invite everyone, wherever you are, to take your hymnals and turn to song number 383, O Day of Rest and Gladness.
Enjoy the Sabbath from earth to things above.
New grace is ever gaining from this our day of rest. We seek the rest remaining in mansions of the
We're going to go to song number 384, Safely Through Another Week. And indeed, we are grateful that we are safe. Take out your hymnals. Take out everything that you can to get the lyrics. Let's sing.
Safely through another week, God has brought us on our way. Let us now a blessing sea, waiting in His cause to
come on, sing, they are all.
They are all, the weak, the best, emblem of eternal rest. They are all, the weak, the best, emblem of eternal rest. While we seek supplies of rest
through the dear Redeemer's name. Take away the sin and shame.
Take away our sin and shame. From our worldly cares set free, may we rest this day in Thee. From our worldly cares set free, may we rest this day in Thee. When the poor shall lead us round,
go to song number 330, song 330. Take my life and let it be. going to sing number 428, 428, Sweet By and By. There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we shall see it afar. Come on, everyone, let's sing.
There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar.
For the Father,
for the Father, we over the way to bring.
Come on, everybody, wherever you are, sing the song in the sweet.
In the sweet. In the sweet, sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. We shall sing on that beautiful shore the melodious songs of the blessed, and our spirits shall soar on the horn. Don't just sigh for the blessed.
Come on, sing in the sweet. I just wanted to slow it down a bit so that you can all sing. Come on, sing in the sweet.
In the sweet, by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet, by and by,
we want to do that chorus again.
We shall meet.
No matter what you are going through, sing in the sweet. Come on, sing that song.
The sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore.
Amen. Song number 27, rejoice, keep you in heart. Rejoice, give thanks and sing. Your festal banner wave on high, the cross of Christ your King. I want everyone to sing that song. Come on, rejoice, keep you in heart.
Rejoice, keep your in heart. Rejoice, keep thanks.
Saints of
earth,
for are the strains of joy and peace. The song says, true rapture, no blessed.
Still chanting as we go from you.
on high.
Praise He who reigns on high. The Lord whom we adore. The Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. One God forevermore.
That this was wonderful singing.
It was amazing singing. Lovely blend of voices.
Yes, it was. And I'm sure that we are all at home rejoicing.
Yes, indeed.
Hearts are glad.
Yes, I'm seeing the comments. They are really enjoying the service thus far.
We'd like to thank our praise team and also the musicians who are from the Maranatha SDA Church.
Indeed. Praise the Lord for that. Let me remind you, if you're just tuning in, viewers, listeners, the General Conference has begun 100 days of prayer. And it began yesterday. So you can join them simply by signing up on this website, www.revivalandreformation.org/100days. www.revivalandreformation.org/100days. At this time, we have the first prayer segment. And that is being done by Pastor Kenneth Rigobert. It is the scripture reading and prayer. We take you to the main stage at this time.
God has been good to us, and we have this opportunity and privilege to turn to Him in times like these. And so today, in line with the submission of the General Conference, the 100 days of prayer and fasting, we shall focus on two aspects: the fear that the COVID-19 virus generates in us. We shall pray that God replaces this fear with His peace. And China is, although they are a little bit over the hill, but the after effects are there, and so we are going to pray for that. But before we do, we want to reassure ourselves that in the midst of it all, God is with us. And so I want us to just turn a little bit to the book of Psalms, chapter 46. And after we've done this psalm, we shall pray. The psalmist says, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore will not we fear, though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with the swelling thereof. Verse 7 says, the Lord of hosts is with us. Somebody got to say amen. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Verses 10 and 11 says, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. So in the midst of this COVID-19 pandemic, let us not forget that the God who made this earth has not abandoned it. And He's away, as the deist believes. But He is right in the midst of us. And so for this reason, we shall turn to Him to be with us, and to guide us, and to direct us, and to give us His peace. Shall we bow our heads for prayer? Our merciful Father and our gracious God, we come to You in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, our big brother and our friend, one who is touched with the feelings of our infirmities and in all points tempted like we are. We are grateful to know that Jesus knows our experience and that Jesus has not abandoned us. So we are grateful for that. And so this morning, in the name of Jesus, we ask that You have mercy upon us. We ask that You forgive us for our sins. We ask that You cast us not away from Your presence and you take not your Holy Spirit from us. And so, Lord, we pray in the name of Jesus, you would take control of this situation. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, the fear that we experience, that is experienced by most persons, as a result of the constant reminder of what is happening in the world as it's generated by the news, what COVID-19 is doing. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray that you take away this fear and replace it with your peace. Paul says, or rather Peter says, for you have not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of a sound mind. And oh God, we are reminded when the three Hebrew boys and Daniel were taken into captivity, in the midst of the trouble, they were not afraid. They trusted you. And even when they were threatened to be thrown in the fire, you were right there with them in the midst of the fire. And when Daniel was in the lion's den, he was right there with him in the lion's den. And we have no doubt today that you are with us. We commit the medical professionals into your hands. Those who are on the front line. Gracious God, take away fear from them also. Give them boldness. Teach them how to be careful. And may your Holy Spirit take control of them, that they would do their work in a way that would restore people's health. We pray for the government. They too, Father, some of them do not even know how to control this situation. I commit them into your hands. Take away fears. Take away doubts. May your spirit take control of them so that this situation could be placed under control. And then we commit China into your hands, where this thing started. We pray, Father, in the name of Jesus, that even though that they are over the hill a little bit, but the after effects are still there. We pray that you take control of the situation there. You would grant healing, you would grant recovery. But above all, Father, and more importantly, we ask that this situation, you will use it to bring to the consciousness of every man, every woman, every boy, every girl upon this face of this earth, to help them understand like Nebuchadnezzar understood, that there is a God who reigns over the affairs of men and rules in the kingdom of men. And I pray, oh God, as a result, your Holy Spirit will be able to bring conviction. And persons who do not believe in you, the skeptics, the agnostics, the deists, those people who do not believe in your existence, would see your hand and as a result, like Nebuchadnezzar, come to call you Lord. And Father, when Jesus comes to save his people, save us, we ask, in the name of Jesus. Let all those who believe in Jesus say amen. Amen.
Thank God for prayer. Can you imagine, Anna, life without prayer?
I don't even want to begin imagining life without
yes.
prayer.
Yes. Thank God we have a God who listens to our feeble prayers and answers us. I mean, I look at my mom, for example. She was a warrior. I don't mean a prayer warrior. A warrior. She would think about things that could happen that has not happened. She'd be so fearful. But now she's a praying woman, and all fear has dissipated. Amen. Praise the Lord for that. Amen. Up next, we have the children's corner. And one thing I like to say that I like about the Adventist Church is how organized it is. They cater to every department, children, women, men, youth, every department. It's very organized. So we have the children's corner up next and the lesson study as well.
But Wendy,
yes,
from the time I entered here, I've been looking forward to one item. And that is the special music.
I knew that. You're a chorister, right?
Yes, I am.
All right, so
and
we have special music.
I've been looking forward to it because it is Sister Renata Charmaine.
Ah.
So without further ado, we will now be favored with special music by Sister Renata Charmaine.
Praise the Lord.
everyone, it's Aunt Fernita. Today's story is called Let the Children Come. The memory verse is from Luke chapter 18, verse 16. It says, "Let the little children come to me, and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these." Today's message is children like me are welcome in God's family. Can you remember a time when an important visitor came to your town? What did everyone do? Were there pictures in the newspaper? Did you stand and wave a flag? In our story today, someone very important has just come to town. It may have happened like this. Have you heard the news? Jesus is in town. Over and over, people in the town told one another the news. Jesus is here. Everyone wanted to see Jesus. Men left their work and hurried to hear him speak. Friends and families helped sick people get near him. They had heard how he had healed others. Maybe he would heal them too. Everyone was amazed as they watched Jesus with the people. They saw blind men and women see again. They laughed with the lame people who could leap and jump again. They saw mothers and fathers and children well again. Everyone was helped. No one was turned away. When some of the mothers heard about Jesus, they wanted to see him too. They wanted him to bless their children. The children were excited. They were going to see Jesus. Children everywhere loved Jesus. He smiled at them. He spoke kindly to them and told wonderful stories. He loved the flowers and other small gifts they brought him. Soon, some of the mothers hurried through the town. They called to their friends, "Come with us to see Jesus." Children told their friends, and soon many were hurrying to see Jesus. But the mothers with small children could not go very fast. It took time for the toddlers to walk. Finally, all the mothers and children reached the crowd around Jesus. They stood at the back, trying to look over all the tall people in their way. Some of the small children may have tried to crawl forward, but they could not get near Jesus. Everyone wanted to see him. It seemed as if everyone was pushing, trying to get nearer. The mothers felt as if it were hopeless. Could anyone help them see Jesus? Maybe his disciples would help them. The mothers led the children to the disciples. The disciples frowned at them. They shook their heads. "Go away. Can't you see Jesus is busy? Can't you see he is tired?" Jesus saw what was happening. "Wait," he said. "Let the little children come to me. Don't stop them. The kingdom of God belongs to people who are like these little children." The disciples and the crowd were amazed. The mothers and children hurried to Jesus. He spent a long time with them. He took the children onto his lap and blessed them. Maybe he told the mothers how much he loved the children. Maybe he talked about how they could raise their children to love God. We don't know what Jesus said to the mothers and children that day. But we can be sure that he was not angry at them for wanting to be with him. He was happy. He was glad to talk with them. Jesus always loves children and parents, and he wants you to come to him today. He wants you to be a part of his family too.
Created and produced by Falvo Fowler. This podcast is read by Franita Buddy Fullwood for Gracelink.net. Animation and artwork by Giorgio Godoy. Audio is post-produced by Faith Toe at Studio L.
The tomb of Buddha looked inside and saw his bones. Then I traveled on to see Muhammad still wrapped up in his grave clothes. So I journeyed to a garden where old Joseph left him lay. The precious lamb, God's own begotten, he was no longer in that grave. If you knew him like I know him, you would know that he's alive. If you felt him like I feel him, resurrection deep inside, you'd know he's living and death has died. If you're wandering in the darkness, come and step into the light. Nail-scarred hands reach out to help you, to pull you safe from death to life. Friends, I too have stood where you stand. Could I trust in things unseen? But just one step in his direction, and then in love he ran to me. If you knew him like I know him, you would know that he's alive. If you felt him like I feel him, resurrection deep inside, you know he's living and death has died. You ask me how I know he'll live. He lives within my heart. If you felt him like I feel him, resurrection, you know he's living and death has died. Death has died.
Thank you very much. That was beautiful singing. And let me take this. This was beautiful singing and a wonderful song. Let me take this opportunity to welcome all of you who are sitting in with us, our class this morning, wherever you are around the world. We are happy to have you. It's always a privilege when we could sit and study the Word of God together. this morning to do this with me. We're doing this thing together. To my right, handsome young man, Silas, Elder Silas Missoul. Elder Silas is the first elder for his church, Morning Post Seventh-day Adventist Church, ordained elder with the blessings of God. We're happy to have you for us to study the lesson together. Recently I just was his elder, not his pastor, not too long ago. So I'm in good company today. Next to my left is Elder Thomas Shalmine, also an ordained elder and an elder of his church serving at this time. A young man that I know for some years now.
Yes, for sure,
Elder. Amen. This morning, we want to spend the next few minutes, the next half an hour, on the Word of God. The Word of God. Now, we are open for questions. So if you have any question on what we are studying, please, you could send in your questions and we will acknowledge your questions. We would like to let you know in advance that we do not know everything. We will answer you to the best of our ability. And we rest assured that God has all answers we don't have. So we want to start with our lesson study. Our lesson for this week is entitled From Dust to Stars. From Dust to Stars. When I looked at the title, I wondered, what in the world is this? And so I went to the scripture reading, and I would, Daniel chapter 12, the scripture really, yes, verses 2 and 3. And Daniel says, and many of them that sleep in the dust, note that word, dust of the earth, shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting contempt. And verse 3 says, and they that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the firmament, and they that turn many to righteousness as the stars. Note that word, as the stars forever and ever. I think we should pray before we continue.
Yes.
And I think we should ask Elder Chalmine, would you mind praying for us?
Okay, Pastor. Let us pray. Our heads bowed, our eyes closed, we pray. Great God of the universe, once again, our eyes can still see. Our minds can still function properly, and there is hope in Jesus.
Amen.
This morning, we present ourselves before you. We present the audience at large into your hands, God. May you help us, your people, to be faithful to you. May you bless our efforts here this morning, and may your name be glorified. Be with us once again, I pray, for
Amen.
Christ's sake.
Amen. Thank you very much, Elder Shalmine. In a nutshell, the title of the lesson is simply saying that those who die in Christ, sleeping in the dust, in Christ, one of those days will be resurrected and they will become stars with God. Yes. That's what it's saying in essence. But as we look at the book of Daniel, we notice that the book of Daniel begins. Now, by the way, if you have any contribution, any question, we just jump in as we continue. The book of Daniel begins with Nebuchadnezzar invading Judea and taking captives Babylon and some important young men with him and carried them to Babylon. But then when we look at again the book of Daniel, we see that it ends, chapter 12, it ends with something directly opposite. The children of God are not being given into captivity or being allowed to be held captive, but the children of God are now being delivered. The people of God are being set free. And so, as we have seen too, Daniel and his companions remain faithful in the midst of this captivity. This is an important lesson that we need to learn from that. In the middle of their captivity, Daniel and his friends, they remain faithful in the midst of it all.
Yes, Pastor. Disappointed.
Yes.
You see, life sometimes can actually give us some very serious times. And sometimes people may ask the question, why me, Lord? But the Bible is, or God is saying to his children, in spite of what you are going through, I understand your plight. I know what you're going through. but I am with you. And when God is with you, you are fighting from a position of power and of strength. And your victory is always guaranteed in Jesus.
Very important point. Very crucial point. Now, I would like us to notice, in the midst of it, they remain faithful.
Yeah.
And I cannot help but see how this is so applicable to us today and in this time. Mm-hmm. Now, we are so concerned about what will be our future. What will life be for us? We cannot go anywhere. We are locked indoors. We cannot go out and play. We have to stay in. But the bills have to be paid. The mortgage must be paid. The rent has to be paid. Food has to be purchased and eaten. And but we cannot go out. We cannot go to work. In the next few months, where are we going to get money to pay the bills? Where are we going to get money to buy food? So we are concerned. We are worried. We are troubled. But the boys, the three Hebrew boys, these boys in the middle of their situation, they remain faithful and they remain steadfast. In the midst of our trouble now, what we are going through, we need to understand God is with us. And we need to remain faithful and we need to remain true. No matter what the challenges are, we need to remain faithful. Brother Lomisol, do you have any contribution?
Of course, I just want to agree that amidst this time, we need to be faithful to our Lord, God, and Savior.
Okay. I would say very, very forcefully that knowing God is relationship. And when you know someone or you have been spending time with this individual, you know when things are hard, this person will come through for you. And God Amen. Is saying to us as his children, I will not leave you nor forsake you. You are my child, and I will show myself strong in your situation. So I want to say to God's people this morning, our friends, that in spite of what you are hearing or what you're experiencing today, if we remain faithful to God, God will take care of you. He will take care of you. Your bread and your water will be sure this morning.
And this is what Daniel is saying in verse 1. He's saying in the midst of our trouble, in the midst of our challenging times, in the midst when things seem bleak, hopeless, helpless, Michael shall stand.
That's right.
God will come through for us in the midst of it all. And he's the one who is going to change the course of history. He's the one who is going to take things and turn it out in the direction that he wants it to go. And by the way, there's a text that I have written down that I kind of escaped. Let me come back to it. Romans chapter 8 and verse 28. And what does Romans 8, 28 says? How many things? All things work together for good to them that love God and are called according to his purposes. According to his purpose. So whatever our situation might be, God can take it and work it in ways for our good and for his glory.
Yes.
And I think as Christians now, I'm speaking here now for St. Lucia, and of course for the rest of the world, because this thing is pandemic, it is all over the world. God will use this situation for our good and for his glory. But let us go back to Daniel 12:1. God is going to stand for us in the middle of it all. He's going to change the course of history for his good, for our good and his glory. Every chapter we go, let's look at Sunday's lesson. We turn into Sunday's lesson. Every chapter of Daniel so far has begun by mentioning the ruler of a pagan nation. There's a question, and we will be, let us see how we could respond.
Yes, one of our viewers asked, what is the significance of the text in Daniel 12:1?
What is the significance? Could I allow, we will respond, but could I allow you to respond?
We would consider that Daniel chapter 11 was speaking about the king of the north and the king of the south. And we had a lot of things going on between those kings. But the scene is changed when Daniel 12 arrives. It says, and Michael shall stand up.
Amen.
Now, we have already observed in our previous discussions that Michael, the archangel, is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So we have already clarified that point. So the text is telling us that the Lord will say, enough is enough. All that has to take place has taken place, and I am coming for my children. So the text is saying, Jesus is coming.
Amen.
Michael will stand up. Who is like God? So when Michael stands up, you have confidence that he will do whatever he's called to do. You have nothing to fear. You have a sure rock to stand upon that Michael will stand for his people. He will surely deliver his people at the right time. So I want to say this morning that don't let fear overpower you. You have someone you can trust. You have a big brother that he will deliver you at the right time.
Amen. I would like us to refer to the lesson. I would like us to refer to the lesson for that one. Sunday's lesson, the paragraph before that, well, the two last paragraphs. It says two important aspects of Michael's work can be inferred from the verb stand, utilized in Daniel 12:1 to describe his action. First, the verb stand evokes the rise of kings to conquer and rule. The verb also primarily connotes in a military sense. It shows that Michael acts as a military leader who protects his people and leads them in a special way during the last stages of the great controversy.
That's right.
Significant. What is significant? It reminds us that Michael will stand to fight and deliver his people.
Fantastic. Yeah.
There's another significant point.
In the
following paragraph, the verb stand also points to a judgment setting. Michael stands to act as an advocate, to use our local language, as an avocat. As an advocate, where my Lord, help me, Holy Ghost. Yes, in the heavenly tribunal, as the Son of Man, he comes before the Ancient of Days to represent God's people during the investigative judgment. Amen. Thus, Michael's rising or standing evokes the military and judicial aspects of his work. And that is significant.
Yeah.
Not only Michael stands to protect his people and deliver his people, but Michael is also representing his people as in a court of law. So when God's people stands before the judgment bar and the name is called Silas Missile, Jesus stands and says, present.
My blood. Yes, sir.
This is my child.
Yes, sir.
My death, Father, the sacrifice I made was for him.
That's right. Yeah.
And God understands that. And so the name calls Shalmine, Thomas Shalmine. And Jesus Christ is present. I am his lawyer. I represent him, my blood. So Daniel 12:1 is very, very significant. And that's a significant for us. It reminds the believers that Michael here is representing his people, both from a military standpoint, defending and conquering the enemy, and also setting his people free. And so that kind of And I have a text here that I would like to also use. 1 John chapter 2 and verse 1. The Bible says, John says, my little children, sin not. But if you sin, you have an
advocate.
Jesus Christ the righteous.
The Lord.
Wouldn't that be nice to have that Jesus on our side?
Yes.
As we transition into our other day.
Okay. We're going into Monday, but before we do so, I believe we have a question.
Next question. Daniel was asked to seal the book until the end of time. Ellen G. White notes that in 1798, the book of Daniel has been unsealed. What is the end of time?
Brother Charlemagne will deal with.
When we come to that, when we come to that part in the lesson, we will respond to it. So stay glued, still connected, and you will be taken care of.
So we're going into Monday's lesson, written in the book. For the purpose of the readers, I'll read the text, Daniel 12, 1. And it reads, reading from the King James Version. And at that time shall Michael stand up, the great prince which standeth for the children of thy people. And there shall be a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation, even to that same time. And at that time thy people shall be delivered, everyone that shall be written in the book. So I'm dealing with written in the book. Now, in Scripture, we are told that there are several books recorded. There are several books recorded. We are told in Revelation 20:12 and Philippians 4:3 that there is a record in heaven, and we have rightly called it the book of life. There is also a book of remembrance, which Ecclesiastes 12:14, Matthew 12:36 and 37, and other references allude to. So there are books that record our life in heaven. Now, the book that we're talking about here is the book of life. What exactly is the significance of this book? And what does it mean? We are told clearly that the people that are delivered, everyone shall be written in that book of life.
Okay. So God's people, God has a record of them.
That's right.
Amen.
And God is not saving people arbitrarily.
Not at all.
Okay.
And also, brother, everyone who accepts Christ as his personal savior, your name is written in that book.
Amen.
Amen.
In that book. But it does not mean that you cannot remove the name. Your actions will determine whether your name remain or remove.
Indeed.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Amen.
So if you remain in relationship with God, your name will be there forever.
Amen.
But if by the way that you fall out of relationship, your actions will remove your name.
Amen.
So my plea this morning is to remain faithful to God, endure until the end, and you will be saved.
Amen.
And the great controversy, our dear sister, she agrees with that point, that those who are in the service of God, who have given themselves entirely to their Lord and Savior, are the ones written in that book. Great Controversy, page 480. Now, our persons are written in that book, Daniel 12:1 says something. It says that there will be a time of trouble. Amen. since there never was, even to that same time. And we see here that something is happening. Mm-hmm. It's not arbitrarily persons are written in that book, but something happens before persons are written in that book. And if we notice, it's talking about the end of time. Mm-hmm. There will be trouble. Difficulty has taken place. And Revelation, Daniel 7 tells us about that as well. In Daniel 8:14, we see something happening as well in that of the pre-investigative judgment. Mm-hmm. So we see a lot of things happening before Michael actually stands up for his people. So some persons are wondering, why are we going through such difficulty? Why is this, there is pestilence? Why are there so many issues, so many problems going around us? What is really happening? When we go to Scripture, we see there will be a time of trouble. And there will be pestilence. There will be so many things.
And that's the reason why Michael would have to stand.
Indeed.
Yes, that's right.
Indeed.
You see, my brother?
So through these difficult times and these trying times, and by the way, Jesus Christ spoke about these times. Amen. And Jesus Christ also said, when we begin to see certain signs like pestilence, he says, this is just the beginning of sorrow. Yeah. And it is in the midst of this thing, this is why Michael after son, but let me allow it.
Yes, my brother. The world experienced some times of trouble before. You have the Holocaust. You have the tsunami a few years ago. And people were troubled. But the Bible is saying here, there is a time of trouble to come that the world has never experienced before. So man within his own strength is limited to handle that problem. Man will look for the answer in every nook and cranny of life. But the Bible is saying to us, that time of trouble will be troublesome.
My brother. Amen. Now, we should note that the rising of Michael reveals that the pre-second coming judgment foreshadowed in Daniel chapter 7, 9 to 14, and in Daniel 8, 14, is now completed. And that is when our Lord and Savior is standing up. So we need to be, our names need to be written in that book of life. That is what we want, for our names to be recorded by our God.
But the question that is in my mind, because there are many persons who just live and they profess the name of God, they profess belief, faith in God, but how do we decide, or not well we, but what would characterize one who is a child of God?
Okay, pastor's asking a very interesting question. What will characterize the child of God?
Or what would be the life of one who is the child of God?
Okay, I believe strongly, someone who is a child of God patterns his or her life after the principles of God. So for example, when you are a child of God, your belief in God would shape you or would change the way of your thinking. Your behavioral pattern will be changed because you have a relationship with God.
Let me read Philippians 4:3. It says, "And I entreat thee also, true yoke fellow," reading from the King James Version, "help those women which labored with me in the gospel, with Clement also, and with all other my fellow laborers whose names are in the book of life." And if you notice in Exodus chapter 32 and verse 32, it says, "Yet now, if thou wilt forgive their sin, and if not, blot me, I pray thee, out of thy book which thou hast written." And Moses is speaking to his God about this. But listen to verse 33. The Lord says clearly, "And the Lord said unto Moses, whosoever have sinned against me, him will I blot out of my book." So the Lord is saying, those who are righteous, those who have accepted me, they are the ones written in my book. Amen. Anyone who is not righteous, then they are not written in the book of in the book of life. And John chapter, 1 John, the few chapters tells us, he who is righteous is of God. So we see that very clearly in the Lord's writings.
And I would like to add also from the book of Galatians chapter 5, because we need to be clear. Sometimes we feel we could live anyhow, just profess the name of God, and that's okay. But the names who would be written in the Lamb's Book of Life, as we look at Galatians chapter 5, it says, starting from verse 16, "This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh." I want you to, but if ye be led of the Spirit, I want to jump all of that. "Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envies, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of which I tell you before, as I have also told you in times past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of heaven." So we need to be mindful who God is going to come to redeem, who Michael is standing for in the last days. Not people who live this kind of life which Paul just described. But in verse 22, he describes who are the type of people God will come to redeem and he's going to stand for. "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such, there is no law." as we prepare and as we live for Christ, these are the kind of things that will characterize us. This is why I asked a question a while ago. What characterizes the person that Michael is going to stand for and finally be saved in his kingdom?
And I think we can go on to Tuesday.
Yes, we should.
We can go on to Tuesday. Now, Tuesday deals with a topic that we love. And my dear brothers and sisters love this subject, which is the resurrection. In fact, our very name speaks about the advent of the Lord. And we know that when our Lord comes, we will be resurrected, those who are righteous.
Amen. Yes.
Daniel chapter 12, verse 2 and 3, and it reads, "And many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting contempt." Yes. And verse 3 continues, "And they that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the firmament, and they shall turn many to righteousness as the stars forever and ever."
Yes, brother. There are two sets of people there. The first resurrection, those individuals are privileged. They are privileged. So all those who will be taking part in the first resurrection will live with Jesus forever and ever. And the second resurrection, after the 1,000 years will finish in heaven and we're coming down from heaven with that great city, then Satan will be loose for a season, and God will destroy the wicked ones, and that will be the end of them. So those who have part in the first resurrection are privileged, and they will be saved and spend their lives with Jesus Christ. Oh, that is a wonderful thing for us.
We have a question.
What qualifies that time of trouble as the worst the world have ever experienced or seen?
What
qualifies this time of trouble when Michael stands up? What qualifies that time of trouble as the worst the world have ever seen or experienced?
We will have the plagues falling down. We will have falling down upon us, and that is more than we could handle.
That's right.
Okay. Also, if we notice, verse 1 takes in account a large part of history. You know, when Michael stands up and he tells you time of trouble, all of these things do not happen at the same time. So it takes into account a large portion of history. Now the question asks, what is the worst? For you to know the worst, you literally have to know everything before for you to know the worst. So I think really and truly we should not be asking what is the worst, but we should be doing what Scripture has asked us to do, to remain faithful to the Lord. Amidst, he has told us the signs, so we need to know the signs and take into account the signs which Matthew 24 rightly identifies to us.
Yes, very good point, Brother Missal. I'm saying that we should try to focus on life. If we focus on life, we give little credence to death. So as God's people, focus on if we remain faithful to God, we will enjoy the best life has to offer. But
let's move on to Thursday.
Okay, Wednesday. Okay, Wednesday. We have some very interesting points on the Wednesday. And persons have been asking a number of questions. And I'm going to go into it directly. On the Wednesday, I'm going to ask a question. Why is the book of Daniel to be sealed until the time of the end? And I hasten to say this morning that some of the key teachings and prophecies remained mysterious at that time. It says again, for example, the prophetic messages related to the purification of the heavenly sanctuary, the judgment, the identity and work of the little horn, the time frame related to those prophecies were far from clear. But I want to say this morning that keep in mind those prophecies were sealed because they were not meant for the time, for that time. And the people at that time could not fully comprehend the prophecies. But however, they are relevant for us today. In fact,
We are living in the time where the prophecies are unfolding, and we are better able to relate to them because we are in that time.
We are experiencing the fulfillment.
Yes, sir.
Therefore, we are able to understand, we are able to analyze. Mm-hmm. But before that, we were not able. Mm-hmm. Therefore, it had to be sealed because it was not relevant or applicable to the time.
It says again that, however, it was only at the time of the end that the book finally was opened and people were able to understand. What is the time of the end? Someone has been asking that question. Time of the end and the end of time, it's two different things. Time of the end, the event which precedes the coming of Jesus. So in time of the end, and look at me, and the time of the end started from 1844. So the event, time of the end, and the end of time is actually the coming of Jesus. Jesus coming to take his children home. He's coming to take his children home. So I'm here to tell you that we are living in the time of the end. We are living in a time where prophecy is unfolding rapidly and things are happening. But I want to say to us this morning, we need to remain faithful unto God. Faithful to God. Because God has promised to stand for his children. It also says that, and men shall run to and fro, and knowledge will be increased. You see, friends of mine, men will be going and search the prophecies, the scriptures. There will be what is called a resurgence of people delving into the word of God and understanding the prophecies, understanding the time that we are living in, said, and also knowledge will be increased. That knowledge, friends of mine, speaks about people will understand, they will have information of what is taking place in the last days. But it does not negate the fact that there will be an advancement in science and technology. But the most important point is that people will understand what is taking place in the last days.
Amen. We see the time is running out on earth, and so we want to kind of wrap it up a little bit. So we're going to Friday. I would like to read for us the summary of Friday. We need to understand the times that we are living in. We need to understand that we are living at the time or in a time when Jesus is about to put in his appearing. Okay. And Jesus Christ told us what is going to be, what the signs we're going to see. Mm-hmm. And we're seeing them already. Yes, the events are shaping up. The Apostle Paul warned the church not to look for the coming of Christ in his day. That day shall not come, he says, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin revealed. An apostasy would have taken place before the coming of Jesus Christ. And when we talk about apostasy, we're not talking about one or two individuals. We're talking about the Christian faith would have fallen away from the original faith. And so Paul says, before Christ comes, this will happen. He says, not till after the great apostasy and the long period of the reign of the man of sin can we look for the advent of our Lord, the coming of Jesus Christ. And that man of sin is also the mystery of iniquity, the son of perdition, that wicked, and that represents the papacy. That system, that religious system that replaced God with man, that replaced the worship of God with the worship of idols.
that replaced the intercessory ministry of Jesus with the intercessory ministry of saints. And so, the coming of Christ could not take place before that time. Paul covers us with his caution the whole of the Christian dispensation down to the year 1798. It is this side of time that the message of Christ's second coming is to be proclaimed. Let us remain faithful and true to God.
Yes.
This mystery of iniquity has been revealed. Jesus is about to come. Let us be ready.
And we want to thank Pastor Kenneth Rigobert, also Brother Shalmine and Brother Miso for the lesson study. You know, we never have enough time, Anna, for lesson study because there are so many questions, so many things to look at. And we just want to apologize to our viewers, those of you who sent in questions that we could not visit. It was due to our short time slot. But we want to encourage you to continue studying for yourselves and continue to pray because the time is so short, we will be without excuse. Let us use our time wisely.
At this time, we just have one short announcement. For all LABE SDA Church members, you are asked to kindly pick up your quarterly for the new quarter this afternoon from 2 to 3. But please be reminded that we are still practicing social distancing.
That's right.
So all are asked to just pick up and leave. So that is from 2 to 3.
Amen. All right, now, we have been getting a glimpse as to what heaven will be like. You know why I say that?
Why?
Because we have so many countries and islands tuned in to this national Sabbath service at this very time in this one platform. We have people from Virginia, the Emmanuel family is tuned in to this service. We have people from Oklahoma tuned in. We have Trinidad and Tobago. We have St. Martin, Brother Amos Sergis. We just want to say happy morning and happy Sabbath to you.
Yes, we do. We have Ava McCall from Trinidad and Tobago. We have Felix Wells from Oklahoma. We have Jovan Howell right here in St. Lucia.
Mm-hmm.
We have Kenifa Alexis from Canada and Teresa Marshall from Trinidad and Tobago.
Amen. We welcome you and we're happy that you are joining us for this national service. You see, whatever happens, God always has a way that his church will continue. We will always have a platform to spread the gospel until he says, let them alone. And we don't want that to happen and we don't have the Spirit of God. So let us continue to do what we should whilst we are able.
Yes.
Up next, we have our health corner, Anna.
Yes, we do.
In a time like this, we want to know how to remain in health, right?
Yes, we do.
And we have a very familiar face and voice. We have Brother Taylor Everest, who is a gospel medical missionary. He also hosts the program on Praise FM Health for Today. He will be the one doing our health corner. Now, you mentioned earlier about you were so eager to hear Sister Shalmine sing.
Yes, I was.
I saw why. And guess who gets all the glory? God.
Yes,
because
he does.
God blessed her with that voice, and she sang beautifully. We saw all the comments. Everyone was blessed to hear the voice. And we have more praising coming on after the health corner. So please, listeners, keep it locked for the health corner and the praise session, because praising and singing plays an integral part in worship.
In our worship. Yes, it does.
There's a reason why God blessed his church with such beautiful voices. I remember early in my Christian walk, people would tell me, how come Seventh-day Adventist people can sing? It's like all of you can sing. I wonder why.
Because I tend to disagree, but that's okay. We'll go back to that.
We all have various levels and various gifts, but it tends to be quite common that we are able to sing, and God is the one blessing us with that talent.
Amen.
I just pray that we all continue to use it for his honor and his glory.
Yes.
We just want to remind you, listeners, that the General Conference has started an initiative, and We want you to join. By joining, all you have to do is log on to www.revivalandreformation.org/100days. That is the platform to join in the 100 days of prayer and fasting. It started yesterday, and the theme for this week is
peace in the midst of a pandemic.
That's right. Peace in the midst of a pandemic. Without further ado, we take you to the main stage for the Health Corner by Brother Taylor Everest.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. And I'm here to do the Health Corner. Today we want to talk about nutrition. In a time like this, it is extremely important that God's people and the rest of the world know how to use food as a medicine. And even now, we could see outside the supermarkets, the long line, and most places are closed, and some countries are shut down. And soon, we don't know what we'll face. So God have designed in such a way for us as his people to use food as our medicine and just to use the basic means that we have that we could have good health. Also today, I want to share with you how to use those foods to build up a strong immune system. Again, the Bible says in the book of Genesis, chapter 1, verse 29, it says that God says, "See, I have given you every herbs that yielded seeds, and every tree whose fruits yielded seeds to you, it shall be for food." In the beginning that God gave Adam and Eve the original diet, the best of the best, and everything that man would need to survive was to be found in the Garden of Eden. And what did God give them? He gave them fruits, he gave them the seeds, he gave them the nuts, he gives them the grains. And then in Genesis chapter 3, God added to the diet the vegetables. In the book Ezekiel chapter 47, verse 12, Ezekiel made it clear that our food is the best medicine that we could ever have. In other words, what the Bible is teaching us, whatever you put in your mouth, it's supposed to be nourishing you. It's supposed to be fighting diseases in our body. Anything that you put in your mouth that will not nourish you and it's not fighting for you, then it is killing you. It's a poison. What are the three foods that the body really needs? The three kinds of mineral that the body needs to be able to sustain it? We need carbohydrates and fat. And the reason for that, carbohydrates and fat, it provides the body with energy. The body also needs proteins and minerals, which is used to build tissues. Vitamins, that is to facilitate the chemical reaction in our body. How can we find those three kinds of minerals to sustain us? Can we find it just in the Garden of Eden or on a plant base? Well, let me read to you from the Council of the Prophetess, Ellen G. White, from the book Counsel and Diet of Food. That is page 81. She says, "The grains, in grains, fruits, nuts, and vegetables are to be found all the elements that we need." My friends, God did not make a mistake. God knows what's best for us. Amen? Again, these are the foods that we need to stay away from in a crisis like this. You don't want to get sick. The hospital is overwhelmed. They are burdened with situations. And if you get sick now, it will be a big problem for you yourself. And those foods are things like meats, eggs, chicken, and dairy products. Can you imagine? The health system is telling us to stay away from it. And these are things that we know long, long, long ago from the Word of God. Things like fried foods and sugar, and processed food like ice creams and the burgers and the fries. These foods should be forbidden, especially in a time like this. The soda and sugar is a sweet killer. It suppresses the immune system and it prevents our body from fighting viruses and bacteria, especially in a time like this. Now, these are the foods that we should eat. that will build a strong immune system. They are packed with phytonutrients and phytochemicals. They boost up the immune system and help the body to be ready, the little soldiers in us, the NK cells, the natural killer cells, and the T cells to destroy those bacteria and those viruses. And this food, for a good breakfast, what you need a bowl of fruits. A good breakfast, you start with a bowl of fruits. And that fruits, you don't have to use imported fruits. Use what that has been grown on the island of St. Lucia, wherever you are. A bowl of fruits, about 3 to 5 different kinds of fruits. You don't have to eat a whole fruit, a slice an inch. This would be sufficient. Then you have a bowl of whole grain cereal. Oats is very cheap, so you could use your whole oats and other whole grains of your choice. You could have a slice of whole wheat bread with that, with a little spread of some butter that you make. I'm talking about vegan butter. Or you could have some nut butter on there or some spread. This would be a good breakfast. A good lunch that would be 5 hours later would be very simple. You don't need to go to the supermarket. You could just go to your backyard and get everything that you need. It is time that God's people learn how to use the soil to plant again. And a simple, healthy, well-balanced breakfast, it would be just picture or just look at this. The plate is divided into 3 sections. Half of your plate should be vegetable. So you want a large bowl of vegetable. And with that, you would need some starch. You could use what you plant or what the soil grows as your starch. In addition to that, you could have a little portion of whole grain rice and or brown rice, and then you could have a slice of green fig, a slice of yam. This would be a nice balanced breakfast, but you need the protein. Where can we find protein apart from the animal kingdom? We have a number, variety of peas and beans. So just add your peas and beans, and after this, after lunch, guess what you should have? A handful of nuts. So you are packed with proteins and have a basic, very simple, not expensive, well-balanced diet. You would notice that I'm not talking about dinner. Supper should be very simple. Breakfast, it should be like a king. And lunch, you eat like a prince. But in the evening, you can skip supper. But if you choose to do supper, do something light for supper. And do it about 6 o'clock. So don't eat late in the night, at least 3 hours before bedtime. Now guess what time you should go to bed? Before 10 o'clock, at least 9:30 for the latest. Make your plate look like the color of a rainbow. So those vegetables, the different colors, the different phytochemicals and phytonutrients in there, and the body needs them. So make your plate look like the color of a rainbow. Say, for example, you have the green leafy vegetable. You could have some carrots in there and some other vegetables of different colors. Let your supermarket be the market or your backyard garden, because these foods are packed and loaded and they are not processed. Again, let me quote for you. The Bible in the book of Isaiah, in Isaiah 54 verse 2, in the Bible, I like this version just for this text, as the Bible, the messenger. It says, why do you spend your money on junk food? Your hard-earned cash on cotton candy. Listen to me. Listen well. Eat the best. Don't you deserve the best? Of course we do. Fill yourself with only the finest of all. And again, in the book of John, chapter 6, verse 35, the Bible says, and Jesus said unto them, I am that bread of life. He that hunger and he who believes in me should never be hungry of thirst again. Let me read that again. He said, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger, and he who believe in me will never be thirsty again. Don't you want to eat that bread? That one of these days will never be hungry again? Well, Jesus says, if you accept him today, he will feed you and fill you that you should never be hungry again. Let me end with this quotation. In the book Exodus chapter 15, verse 26, with all that is going on, our hearts is troubled. But this is what the Bible says. Exodus chapter 15, verse 26. God says unto his people, if thou wilt diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God, and will do that which is right in his sight, and will give ear to his commandments, and keep his statutes, I will put none of these diseases upon thee, which I have put upon the Egyptian. And God promised and assured us today by telling us, for I am the Lord that healeth thee. Hallelujah. My friends, there is hope today. In the midst of chaos, God is calling his people to return back to basic. Embrace what he has given us. God promises life in abundance. Let us not harden our heart and do what's right in the sight of God. God bless you as we continue to serve him. Stay faithful wherever you are. God bless.
So Wendy.
Yes, Anna.
My heart was not... I was not angry when I listened to Mr. Taylor.
It shouldn't be.
Let me tell you why.
Oh, tell me, sister.
For the first time, I can be happy that I am actually attempting something which was said.
Wow.
This week, I decided to start my own vegetable garden.
Ooh.
And as much as I let my sister do all the work in clearing and everything, I know that I will enjoy the harvest.
Well, I can relate to that because I have always had my garden. In fact, gone are the days when I depended on a certain supermarket for my strawberries. Now I reap my own strawberries.
So Wendy, after that I can come by you?
I knew that would come. Only if I can come by you for your vegetables.
That's fine, as soon as they're ready.
So we realize that having a healthy body is not rocket science.
It's simple.
Praise God for that. Thank you so much, Elder Taylor Everest, for the Health Corner. So up next, we have some wonderful singing.
Yes, we do.
We spoke about singing a while ago, and some of the viewers joined in the conversation. One said, well, I know I cannot sing, but many agreed that we do have that talent in the church. So we will have the praise segment once again.
And we invite you all to sing along, to stand, and to, if you have to, get out of your seat and rejoice. Because this is the day that the Lord has made, and we should be rejoicing and be glad.
Yes, what I've been learning is that we do not praise God enough. In fact, we wait for when things are fine to praise God. But we should be praising God in all things,
yes,
in whatever we are experiencing. Especially now, God's people should be rejoicing and baffling Satan by rejoicing, and let God inhabit our praise. So we have the Maranatha praise team once again to join the world in praising our God who is worthy. So without further ado, we take you to the main stage.
Morning once again, church. We want you to get out your phones, get out your tablets. We're gonna sing Light of the World. You step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see. Beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Here I am, church.
Together, wonderful, to
glorious in heaven
above.
The song says, humbly you came.
Humbly you
to,
came
the earth you created.
To the earth you created.
All for love's sake. Be careful. Everyone, wherever you are, sing, here I am.
Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. Altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful.
The song says, I'll never know. Come on, sing.
I'll never know.
Above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. So I just invite everyone wherever you are, feel God's presence and sing that song above all. Above all nature,
above all nature, and all created.
Come on, get out the lyrics on your phones. Come on, above all wisdom,
above all wisdom,
and all the ways of
man. And all the ways of man.
The song says, you were here.
You were there before the world began.
Above all kingdoms, above all worlds.
Above all.
Treasures of
the treasures of the earth.
There is no way.
There's no way to measure what you're worth.
Come on, join in the chorus and sing crucified.
Crucified, laid behind the stone. You live to die, rejected and alone. Trampled on the ground, you took a fall and thought of me above all.
Gonna go up from the top, above all powers,
above all powers,
above all kings,
above all.
Above all nature,
above all nature,
all created things,
and all created.
Come on, feel God's presence. Above all wisdom,
above all
the song
wisdom,
says, and all the ways of man.
All the ways of
come on,
man.
I need to hear you singing from your houses. You were here before the world began.
You were here before the world began.
Above all kingdoms, above all thrones.
Above all.
song says, above all wonders,
above all wonders, the world has ever.
My God is bigger than all the money in the world, above all wealth,
above all wealth
and treasures,
and treasures of the earth.
There's no way.
There's no way to measure what you're.
Wherever you are, come on, sing that chorus. It says, crucified.
Christian people, once again, I want to say it is a good privilege to be in the house of God. One thing about God, He's always there for His children. This morning, friends of mine, I would like to talk about prayer. And one thing I want us to realize this morning, that prayer is the engine oil for the Christian. And where there is much prayer, there is much power. And the theme for this week is peace in the midst of an epidemic. I want to say, friends of mine, that we are going through this pandemic in this world. Countries are fearful. People are fearful. People are dying. But I want to say this morning that there is joy in serving God, because God's people will be protected by God. This morning, friends of mine, as we examine the book of Isaiah chapter 43, and we are going to examine two verses, verse 1 and verse 2, I shall read in your hearing. But now thus saith the Lord that created thee, O Jacob, and he that formed thee, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed thee. I have called thee by thy name, thou art mine. Verse 2, when thou passest through the waters, I will be with thee. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. And when thou walkest through the fire, thou shalt not be burned, neither shall the flame kindle upon thee. This morning, I am here to tell you as God's people, the devil is on a mission of destruction, but God has always been in the saving business. He said that he will be with you. Have no fear. This morning, I want to pray especially for our members in Kenya and other African countries who are struggling because their open-air markets are closed. And we also want to pray for our preachers, our teachers, our Bible workers, and other who may be able, will not be able to carry out the face-to-face ministry as before. We are living in challenging times. But I want to say to us this morning, God is in control and he will see his people through. Peace in the midst of a pandemic. Let us bow our heads as we pray. The great God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the one who spoke life into existence, this morning we call upon your name because we believe that there is healing in your name. There is power in your name. There is grace in your name. So we call upon your name, dear God, because we know that you have all power. This morning, especially, we present our members from Kenya into your hands. You know, God, that this world has been going through a time of difficulty, a challenging time. But this morning, God, we realize that there is still favor in your hands. We realize, God, that in spite of the fear, the fearful nature of life, but your people can rest assured knowing that with Christ all things are possible. We pray, dear God, that you may show yourself strong on the behalf of your people. Help us to realize, dear Jesus, that in spite of everything, you will stand for your people at the right time. At this time, I present our preachers into your hands, our teachers into your hands, our Bible workers into your hands, dear God. You are the God who parted the Red Sea. When Daniel was in the lion's den, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they were thrown in the fiery furnace, yet they were not fearful because they trusted that God will take care of them. This morning, we believe that you will take care of us. You have taken care of us in times past, and you are faithful to take care of us at this time, Father. We present our government. They are perplexed. They are troubled. But even now, I pray, dear God, that you may work out a plan for them. May they be able to stay calm in this time of desperation and invite you in the business. Because we realize that when you are in the camp of the righteous, victory is guaranteed. So once again, God, put a hand on our behalf. Bless us, but help us to remain faithful to you until the end, knowing that when God is wrong, there he will take care of us children. So, Father, in the midst of this pandemic, we can still trust you and call you our Father. Bless us once again, I pray, in Jesus' name.
We thank Brother Thomas Charlemagne for this season of prayer. And the praise team who got us well heated up.
I wanted to get out of my seat.
I noticed. And I see our viewers, our listeners had a wonderful time praising as well. Thank you so much, praise team. Thank you so much, Brother Thomas Charlemagne. Up next, we have a special item of music done by Tatiana Patrice that will come up next. But before that, I know you have a special promo for us.
We actually, in regards to the announcement which was made earlier to the LABE SDA Church members, steps have been put in place to maintain social distancing. So if you do wish to pick up your quarterlies, you may do so.
Praise the Lord for that.
And we also have a special promotion. Members are asked to contact their pastors regarding their tithe and offerings arrangements, which are being made to cater for everyone.
Amen. So contact your local church pastor to find out how you can remit your tithe and offering. Without further ado, we take you to Sister Tatiana Patrice with a special item of music. Be blessed.
What shall I do? What steps should I take? What move? I make? Oh Lord, what shall I do? I'm going to wait for an answer from you. I have nothing to lose. Oh Lord, I'm going to wait. I know you'll come through. Lord, set my soul free. Oh Lord, I know you'll come through. I can't live without your
Jesus.
what shall I do?
I'm going to
Hallelujah.
Man, we were indeed blessed.
That was one of my favorite songs. I think I should go home now because I'm so blessed.
Oh, I saw you rocking away. We'd like to thank Sister Tatiana for such a wonderful item of music.
Yes, indeed. But guess what, Anna?
What?
The King of the universe sent someone here to break the bread for us, for the world today.
And who might that be?
Well, he sent the president.
Our own president.
Not Trump. He sent the president of the St. Lucia Mission of Seventh-day Adventists, Pastor Roger Stephen. Yes. He's the one breaking the bread for us today. And I'm excited about that.
I look forward to hear what he has to say.
Indeed. So without further ado, we want to bring you to the main stage. But I just want to remind our listeners of the promo you had earlier before we go on to breaking of the bread.
We just want to remind all members to contact their pastors in regards to your tithe and offering and how you could bring it in.
Indeed.
Because arrangements have been made to cater for each and every one.
Yes,
of us.
And we are also keeping up to the rules with social distancing and hand sanitizing and 10 or less. We are maintaining the rules.
Yes, we are.
Don't be afraid or fearful of how we're going to collect our tithes and offerings and even our quarterlies. So we just mentioned that we have the president that will be doing the sermon for us this morning / afternoon, almost afternoon. So keep it locked, viewers. It's time for some real meat.
Yes, it is.
Without further ado, we take you to the main stage, Pastor Roger Stephen.
Thank you very much, Wendy and Anna. It's good to be here to be speaking to all of our brothers and sisters throughout St. Lucia, the region, and the world. Thank you for being glued to our platforms. Those of you, I know there are many persons viewing online from Canada, from New York, and many other places. We thank God. Just before I speak, I must, as the president, thank LNO Studios, Lance Octave and LNO Studios for this phenomenal job that they are doing, and all those who have been participating in ensuring that this program is carried live to our members. Thank you so much. God bless all of you, those of you in the background. Today, I have chosen to speak to you on the topic, COVID-19, a godly response. COVID-19, a godly response. Bow your heads with me wherever you are as we pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for all that you have done for us and all that you are doing through us. This morning, even as I speak a word to your people from all over the world, Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit will take full charge, be with my thought processes, grant me clarity of speech. And Lord, I pray that your Spirit would anoint me so that at the end of this message, we all will be drawn into a closer relationship with Jesus, in Jesus' name. COVID-19, a godly response. The world waited with bated breath for the turn of another year. Many, as usual, attended their final church service and made a New Year's resolution for 2020. What jubilation, what excitement, what pleasure that accompanied the fireworks throughout the world as the new year was ushered in. Many with high expectancy for greater profitability, others with a sense of skepticism and fear. What would 2020 rule out? But somehow, just into 2 and 3 months of this year, the world is at a standstill. There is a lockdown. Financial markets have crumbled. Aircrafts are grounded. cruise liners are docked, all of them. There is a cry of trepidation throughout the world as COVID-19 has taken over. And it knows no ethnicity. It knows no degree or pedigree. COVID-19 has taken the world by storm. And like never before in recent times, we have seen so many videos, so many stories about this coronavirus. I believe that you have heard enough about this COVID-19. And I shall not take my time to speak about it. But I believe this morning it's time that we flip the page. I would like to let you know, brothers and sisters, that COVID-19, this coronavirus, never took God by surprise. Whether natural or whether biological, God will never be surprised, whether by COVID or anything else. I would like to let you know that we serve a God who is not just omnipotent. We serve a God who is not just omnipresent, but we serve a God who is omniscient. He saw COVID long before it touched this earth. For the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 13, nothing in all creation is hidden from God. Everything is naked and exposed before his eyes. And he is the one to whom we are all accountable. I'd like to say to you, brothers and sisters, that in his love and mercy, the Lord gave us his word long before coronavirus. The Holy Bible forewarned us of things to come in these last days. Not only did the Bible predict these catastrophes, but he warned his children that we need to be watchful. We need to be wise. We need to prepare for the impending doom upon this world. No wonder in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, beginning from verse 1, Paul writing to the Thessalonians, he says, but of the times and the seasons, brethren, he have no need that I write unto you. Verse 2 says, for yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night. Yes, Paul had taught the Thessalonians very well of the soon coming of Jesus Christ. He had also taught them very well in prophetic matters. Paul says, there is no need that I write unto you. But whereas Paul is saying, there is no need to write unto you, but Paul is writing. It means to me, it says to me, brothers and sisters, that this was too important for Paul not to reiterate. He says, you should know the times and you should know the season. The first designates time in duration. The latter draws attention to the characteristics of the time. The first deals with the measurement of time, while the second deals with the critical nature of the time. I'm here to tell us, my friends, that this is not times as usual. Verse 3, Paul says, for when we shall say peace and safety, sudden destruction shall come upon them, as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. For the past few years, we have heard and we have seen the coming together of many world leaders on many different issues, signing treaties, signing alliances, the new world order, and the coming together on climate change. And everyone is promising a better future. Let me tell you this morning, I would just like to share the word with you and say to you that the Bible told us that when they shall speak of peace and when they shall speak of safety, there shall be a sudden destruction that shall come upon them. And verse Paul says, but he, brethren, you are not in darkness that day should overtake you as a thief, but ye are all the children of light and the children of the day. We are not of the night, nor of the darkness. But verse 6, Paul says, therefore, let us not sleep as do others, but let us watch and be sober. Let me say to us this afternoon, no matter how long and with what degree of intensity we keep our eyes on this coronavirus, I'm here to tell you that only God knows how long it shall be upon this earth. Leaders are doing all that they can do and all that they are trying to do, and we applaud them. But we are seeing the powerlessness of humanity as they seek to deal with this COVID-19. But Paul says, it is no sleeping time. No time for slumber. The night is far spent. The day is at hand. You see, our spiritual condition should never be marked by sleep. And the word sleep used here is kafudo. It is a different word that Paul uses when he speaks about the sleep of death. Kafudo, the sleep that Paul is talking about here, is used metaphorically to denote indifference of spiritual realities on the part of the believer. It covers all sorts of moral and spiritual laxity and insensibility. In other words, we as Christians, we have found ourselves in a stupor, a state of ignorance, insensibility, with no defense and inactivity. Jesus, my friends, is about to come as a thief in the night. And Paul says, now is the time to watch and be sober. He says further, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and as a helmet, the hope of salvation. Here Paul changes the imagery to that of a soldier. He says, put on faith and love, which represents the breastplate. The breastplate covers the vital organs of the heart. No soldier ever go to battle without a breastplate. And so I say to you, no Christian, no Seventh-day Adventist, every one of us should now be equipped with faith in God. Now it's not any kind of faith, brothers and sisters, but let me say to you, every single one of us must have a living faith in Jesus Christ. And a love that has no boundaries. And then Paul says, the hope of salvation, it is the helmet. You see, the helmet protects the head. And the head is important for any soldier. And so he says, what should be on our head now is the hope of salvation. Let me say to us, this hope is it's not wishful thinking. It is a confident expectation. Hello, somebody. That only God can make a difference in this crisis for us. Jesus himself says in John chapter 16 and verse 33, these things have I spoken unto you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you may have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. I thank God, he says, in the midst of this coronavirus, there is only one place we can find peace. And this peace can only be found in Jesus Christ. I say to you, cheer up. Cheer up. Why should we cheer up? Because Jesus, our friend and savior, he has overcome the world. Only in Jesus can we have peace. In the midst of the storm, let me just let you know and remind you that Jesus has a good track record. He has never lost a case. We have become a reactive Christians. After Saddam invaded Kuwait, we saw many churches being filled on a Wednesday night, because many persons thought it was Armageddon. And so everybody thought it was the end of the world. And people all of a sudden became spiritual. after 9/11, we are told that Bibles were sold out across the world because there was an event and everybody became spiritual. And now, in the face of COVID, people are asking, why is the church, why are the churches closed? Why can't you open the church? All of a sudden, people have become spiritual overnight. Hello, tell us, we should be living in readiness every day for Jesus. Are you listening to me? We should not wait on events to turn to God. Noah pleaded for 120 years. With the whole nation, he pleaded to repent. But what did they do? They scorned. They laughed. While probation was closing, they were laughing and they were having a merry time. Animals came from the wild and entered the ark while intelligent men stood jeering. The door of mercy lingered until the door of the ark was closed, and they laughed even after probation had closed. But until the clouds darkened and the lightning flashed across the sky, the thunder spoke loudly to the unrepented heart, and all of a sudden they ran to the shut door, but it was too late. I'm here to tell us, now is the time to turn to God and remain in God. Commenting on the experience of Noah, Jesus in Matthew 24 says, now as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until that day Noah entered into the ark. And you know, until the flood came and took them all away, he shall also, the Bible says, so shall also be the coming of the Son of Man. And then Jesus moved. In verse 44, he says, therefore, be ye also ready, for in such an hour as ye think not, the Son of Man cometh. Hear what Ellen White says. Ellen White says in Testimonies, Volume 9, page 11, we are living in the time of the end. The fast fulfilling signs of the times declare that the coming of Christ is at hand. The days in which we live are solemn and important. Plagues and judgments are already falling upon the despisers of the grace of God. But listen to what she says. She continues, they forecast approaching events of the greatest magnitude. She says the agencies of evil are combining their forces and consolidating. They are strengthening for the last great crisis. Great changes, she says, are soon to take place in our world. And the final movements will be rapid ones. Brothers and sisters, I've always said, many people are in church but playing church. Many people are in church but are playing in the river on the bank, waiting for some sign somehow. And after, they'll just make everything right. I'm here to tell you, my friends, and no one thought in March 2020 there would be a lockdown in St. Lucia and the rest of the world, where everyone would be asked to stay in and we can't even open the church's door. The final movements will be rapid ones. And so Revelation chapter 7, 1 to 3 says, and after these things, I saw four angels standing on the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth, that the wind should not blow on the earth, nor the sea or the tree. Verse 2 says, and I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God, and he cried with a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was given to hurt the earth and the sea. Hear what he says, saying, hurt not the earth, neither the sea nor the trees, till we have sealed the servants of our God in their foreheads. Let me tell us this morning, this afternoon, pardon me, it is sealing time. Now is the time to make things right and turn to Jesus. Now is the time for full repentance while time still lasts. It is no more time to sleep. Romans chapter 13 verse 11 says, and that knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep. For now is our salvation nearer than we believed. In the face of this corona, let me just tell you that Jesus has an antidote. Jesus has always had a vaccine for man's virus. With this corona, there are certain protocols that need to be adhered to. Help the preacher, somebody. It amazes me how everyone seem to be so obedient to authorities, and I thank God for that. Only yesterday as I drove, I saw a billboard which says, your health is in your hand. No longer in diet and exercise, your health is in your hand. And the authorities are saying we need to wash for 20 seconds. Wash often. Wash properly. And listen, everybody is washing. Why? Because the song says everybody wants to go to heaven, but nobody wants to die. Everybody wants to remain alive. And so all sanitizers, all gels, and all alcohol-based gels are wiped out of the shelf. Why? Because everyone is protecting the physical life. But let me tell you something. Before corona came, help me somebody, God had already asked us to wash. And God is not just interested in us washing our hands, but God wants us to sanitize our hearts. While we need to wash and sanitize our surroundings, our hands, our everything, there is a better cleansing. God is calling for us to sanitize not just the hand but the heart. David, after he had sinned, committed such heinous act with Bathsheba and then sent Uriah to die. David, in full repentance, went to God, and after Nathan approached him and told him of his sin, David said, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. In other words, I know I have messed up. I know I have done wrong, but help the preacher. I know that if only God can give me a second chance and cleanse my heart, sanitize me, then I know his spirit can be poured in me again. 1 John chapter 1 verse 7 says, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, hallelujah, the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all our sin. I'm here to tell St. Lucia, I'm here to tell all of you viewing, all of you listening to this message, that there is a better and more important sanitization and cleansing, and that is to be cleansed from sin. And whereas there are no sanitizers, hand sanitizers, but the blood of Jesus is still available. Blood of Jesus is available. Ezekiel chapter 36, it says, I will sprinkle clean water upon you, and he shall be clean from all your filthiness and from your idols. I will cleanse you. A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit I will put within you, and I will take away the heart of stone out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh. And then he says, I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and he shall keep my judgments and do them. God today is asking that everyone turn to Jesus in full repentance, in full surrender. He says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face, but then he says, and turn from the wicked ways, he said, then I will hear from heaven, I will forgive their sins, and I will heal your land. St. Lucia, the world, we need to turn back to God in full repentance. Turn to God. COVID didn't just ask us to sanitize our hands, but COVID said to us, you need to practice social distancing. Let me tell us, in the face of COVID, whereas we can't be too close to our brothers, our sisters, and even our family. Help me, somebody. But the Bible says in James chapter 4, help the preacher. When there is social distancing under COVID, the Bible says we can draw near to God. And he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. In other words, when there is social distancing in the world, God does not know social distances. He says, come. Come unto me. When you are laboring and heavy laden, come and I will give you rest. I'm going to come back to it. The third thing that COVID tells us, the third thing that COVID says to us, isolation and quarantine. First, it says, wash our hands. Then COVID says social distancing. And then COVID says we need to practice isolation and quarantine for those who have been affected or maybe appear. I tell you, God has the best quarantine principle. The best principle of quarantine can be found in the Bible. Jacob was in despair after he had tricked his brother for his birthright. And Jacob, as he ran away from Esau, but now he was getting ready to go back and face Esau. He heard a message came to him and said, Esau is coming to you with fury. So Jacob had two wives, children, servants. Jacob sent all of them away. And the Bible says, Genesis 32 and 24, and Jacob was left alone. Hallelujah. This is the best quarantine that we can have when we spend time alone with Jesus on our knees. Some people are uncomfortable because they have always been plagued with noise and songs and all kinds of disturbances. So now they are at home. They can't deal with it. They can't even use that time for family, for prayer, and for study. Let me tell you something. I thank God in one way that this COVID-19 has taught the world how to stay with families. Somebody said what preachers and prime ministers and presidents could not do, COVID did it. COVID has brought families together. But I'm saying the best way to spend your quarantine time is to be left alone with God. It was during his time of quarantine that the Bible says a man wrestled with Jacob until the breaking of the day. And Ellen White says in Great Controversy, Jacob prevailed because he was persevering and determined. His victory is an evidence of the power of importunate prayer. All who will lay hold on God's promises as he did and be as earnest and persevering as he was will succeed as he succeeded. In other words, if we can be alone and spend time, persevere, call upon God and agonize, we will be successful as Jacob was. The song says there is a place of quiet rest near to the heart of God. A place where sin cannot molest. Why? Near to the heart of God. When COVID says quarantine, hello somebody, God says draw near to me and I will draw near to you. Then after COVID, the whole world is affected economically. So everybody is waiting now for the stimulus package. I tell you that whereas man can inject money into this world's economy and call it a stimulus package, let me just let you know that long before men used and knew about a stimulus package, God already had it. Hello, somebody. God already sent a stimulus package to the world. It is recorded in John chapter 3, verse 6. And it says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. What a stimulus package for God, the greatest lover. He so loved the greatest degree, the world, the greatest company, that he gave the greatest act, his only begotten son, the greatest gift, that whosoever, the greatest opportunity, believes, the greatest simplicity in him, the greatest attraction, should not perish, the greatest promise, but the greatest difference, have the greatest certainty, everlasting life, the greatest possession. This is the best stimulus package we can ever have. Why? Because this stimulus package is not limited to earth, but it takes you through a relationship with God on earth, and then it gives you everlasting life when Jesus comes. What a God! No wonder while Jesus walked on earth, he said to the disciples, let not your heart be troubled. He believed in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many mansions. Hallelujah. In the face of COVID, everyone is thinking, I'm going to lose my job, and I'm not going to be able to pay my mortgage. How will I take care of my mortgage? I'm going to lose my property. I'm going to lose everything. I'm here to tell you, my friends, in God's stimulus package, there are mansions in glory for you. It says, I go to prepare a place for you, and I will come again. I will receive you unto myself, that where I am, you will be there as well. May say to us this afternoon, that God, in all of this, God is not asleep. God knows where you are. He knows you. And if you accept Jesus, turn to Jesus, just as he protected the children of Israel when they placed the blood of Jesus on the doorposts and on the lintels, I'm here to tell you, my friends, you have nothing to fear for the future. God will take care of you. And then the next thing COVID has presented us with is that just about every head of state has given power, because they have called a state of emergency. I'll tell you, those of you viewing, those of you listening, no matter where you are, truly, apart from COVID, there has been a state of emergency. Ellen White says, the season of distress and anguish before us will require a faith that can endure weariness, delay, and hunger. A faith that will not faint though severely tried. This is a state of emergency. Everyone is panicking, and sad to say, even those of us who have the sure word of prophecy, we too seem to be panicking. Let me say to us, Jesus has promised that he will never leave us and he will never forsake us. Now is the time to turn to God in full repentance and surrender. In this time of trouble, such as never was, it is a time to present our sins and our faults to God. It is time to make things right with Jesus. I ask the question, according to Jeremiah chapter 12 and verse 5. Jeremiah chapter 12 and verse 5 says, if thou hast run with the footmen, and they have wearied you, how canst thou contend with horses? And if in the land of peace wherein thou trusteth, they weary you, then how wilt thou do in the swelling of the Jordan? What I mean is, according to the prophet, if in time, the times of ease, you are losing faith and losing heart, if in the face of COVID, you are giving up and turning your back on God, what will happen when the real swelling of the Jordan comes? What will happen when the horses come if you cannot contend with the footmen? I'm here to tell you, COVID, whether it will go away in the next few months and everything after stimulus package will seem as if it has come back to normal, I'm here to tell you that this world shall never get better. This world will never get better, my friends. What is ahead is the seven last plagues. What is ahead, my friend, is the Sunday law. What is ahead, my friend, this is just the beginning of sorrow. And now is the time to turn to God and ensure that our faith is grounded in God. This is not the time to cry. Not the time to moan. Not the time to be weary. Not the time to give up. But now is the time to learn to pray. Now is the time to be faithful to God. Remain faithful to God and remain faithful to His church. What is ahead, my friends, is bigger than COVID. But one thing I know, as David, David was able to stand before Goliath because God had given him many trials and he remained faithful in every trial. When the lion came, he took his sling. When the bear came, he took his sling. So when Goliath came, he already knew how to depend on God and his sling. In this time of COVID, I say to us, let us turn to God. In this time of COVID, I say to us, come together with our families, husbands and wives, bring back the family altar. Husbands and wives, bring the family back into prayer. I say to us, in this time of COVID, whereas we need to sanitize, but ensure that your heart is sanitized, is cleansed from all sin. And whereas there is quarantine and social distancing, ensure that we use this time to draw near to God. Draw in a deeper and closer relationship with God. Spend time in His Word. I'm saying to us as we close, that Jesus will come. He says, and he that shall come will come, and he will not tarry. Where are you with God today? What is your relationship like with Jesus today? For some of us, COVID may never kill us, but we will die anyhow. And when we do, what will be our condition when Jesus bursts these clouds of heaven? What will be your condition? My friends, keep trusting God. Keep trusting God. Keep praying. Keep calling upon the Lord wherever you are. And no matter what and how long we would have to weather that storm, I'm saying stay with Jesus. For Jesus has an answer. He has victory for you. Wherever you are today, you might be in the comfort of your living room. You might be listening on Praise FM. At your home, driving in a car somewhere. You might even be in a prison cell somewhere. I would like to let you know that Jesus loves you. He wants to save you. And in the face of this COVID, God has a plan for you. Remain faithful. Remain faithful. As greater things and catastrophes will come upon this earth, remain faithful. For when we go through the waters, He will be with us. When we go through the fires, they shall not burn us. Not even the flames will kindle upon our skins. Why? Because we would have made God our refuge and our strength. Bow your heads with me, wherever you are. Bow your heads with me as we pray and ask Jesus to enter your heart. Ask him to forgive you for your sin. Commit yourself to walking with Jesus. And even after COVID, no matter what happened, continue walking with Jesus until you see him face to face. Bow your heads. Father, we thank you for knowing that your word is a sure word of prophecy. You had already given us all of your word, Lord, and all of your promises. That even when these calamities and pestilences would come upon this earth, you said when we go through the waters, they will not overflow us. You said you will be our refuge and you will be our strength. Oh, Father, I pray that thou would touch your people around the world. Give them hope. Help them to know, dear God, that you are an ever-present help in trouble. You will still be their refuge. Oh, God, help them to know that you are the healer. You are still our balm in Gilead. Oh, Father, help them to know that you died. And if you died, oh, God, there is nothing we can need and nothing we can ask that you will not provide for us. Give your children hope in this time of despair. May we walk with you. May we spend time in prayer, alone with God. May we spend time in prayer with our families. May we make things right with one another and with you. Confess our faults and confess our sins. Help us to know, dear God, that now is the time. No, God, when you come the second time, after all will be said and done on this side of life, when you shall come to take your children home, may all of us stand on the sea that looks like glass and hail you as our Lord and King. And you will say to us, you have been faithful over a few things. Come and I will make you rule over many things. Come and enter the joy of my Lord. May this be what we shall hear from your lips, we pray. And we thank you in the name of Jesus and our friend. Amen and amen.
Amen, amen, amen. Sate bonne nouvelle.
Yes, it was.
Do you speak Creole?
Not really, no.
Neither do I. Okay. All right, so we want to thank Pastor Roger Stephen for this wonderful message. You know, one thing stood out to me. Well, quite a few things, but I just want to highlight just three of them. God is never surprised by anything.
No, he cannot.
This really stood out to me. So we must trust him who is ever ready and always ready to make us ready. And the best quarantine is alone time with God.
Yes,
this really jumped out at me, and I'm sure our viewers and our listeners can say the same. So thank you, Pastor Stephen, for this very, very timely message. Anna, have you ever heard of Praise-a-thon?
No.
Have you ever heard of Marathon?
Yes.
Yes. But have you ever heard of Preach-a-thon?
No, I have not.
There's a Preach-a-thon taking place this afternoon for AY
this
Girl.
This afternoon?
Yes.
What time?
We have at 4 p.m. We have three young and exciting preachers this afternoon. You don't want to miss out on that.
I definitely will be tuned in.
Awesome. That's what's taking place for AY this afternoon at 4 p.m. viewers and listeners. It's a Preach-a-thon. You don't want to miss it.
We'd just like to take time to thank our contributors. We have Praise FM Radio. We also have Nathaniel, who is in the studios at Praise FM. We have the St. Lucia Mission of ASDA. We also have LNO Studios and Great Vision Design TV.
Yes, they have made it possible for us to be in church, even outside of church. Amen. We also want to thank Dwayne Etienne and the praise team from the Maranatha SDA Church. Thank you, Sister Anna Howell, for being here.
And thank you, Wendy.
My pleasure. We also want to thank Pastor Kenneth Rigobert, Elder Thomas Shalmine, and Elder Misol for doing the season of prayer and the lesson study. We want to thank Brother Taylor Everest for the health corner, and of course, the sweet voices from Sister Renata Shalmine and Tatiana Patrice for their special music. We also want to thank you, our viewers and our listeners, for joining us for church today in St. Lucia. Don't forget to sign up for the 100 Days of Prayer via www.revivalandreformation.org. It started yesterday and it continues for the next 99 days because it's 100 days.
And just a reminder that next Sabbath, which is April, we are in April already?
April, yes, it's my month, girl.
So we just want to make a reminder that next Sabbath, April 4th, is a special day of prayer and fasting for the Island Church.
Yes.
So that means every church, there is prayer and fasting next Sabbath. More information will be given later on during the week. You can tune in to Praise FM.
Yes.
For more information.
But this Island Church has become a world church because we had so many tuned in.
So you are also free to join us as well.
Indeed. At this time, we will ask our dear sister Anna to close us in prayer.
We are praying. Dear Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for blessing us for the proceedings here today. We thank you for being with us and providing ways that we may still worship and praise you, although they may have the situation going on. At this time, I pray that you be with us and you guide us throughout the remaining of this day. In your name I pray.
Amen. 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 We will close off in a season of worship from our praise team. Thank you so much for joining us, and don't forget to join us at 4 p.m. this afternoon.
All right. Song number 633, When We All Get to Heaven. What a day of rejoicing that will be. Song says, sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Come on, sing.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing His mercy and His grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, He'll prepare for us a
when we all, when we all
get to heaven. What a day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. We'll sing and shout the victory
while we walk the pilgrim path.
While we walk the pilgrim,
come on, sing. Clouds will overspread the sky. Oh, not a shadow, not a sound. Come on, sing. Just one glimpse.
Will
the toils
of life repay?
When we all
get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
Let's go to the last verse. Onward to the prize. We shall tread the streets of woe. Come on, sing that chorus wherever you are.
When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all,
we're gonna do the chorus one more time. Come on, sing.
Oh, when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
Have a pleasant Sabbath,
hallelujah.
Everyone.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Give God the praise.
We'll be right back. before you with contrite heart. Humbly I surrender all that I am. I want to learn from you. Please draw me close to you. Help me share your love and grace in all I do. Lord, I come before you with contrite heart. Humbly I surrender all that I am. I want to learn from you. Please draw me close to you. Help me share your love and grace in all I do.